Right. Hello, 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 everyone, and welcome to episode number 7 of Fast Casual, Landa's official podcast, brought to you live today, Wednesday, August 2nd, from a whole host of places, from Michigan, from Ireland, from New York, a lot of places today. My name is Alex Mann, and I'm your host, as always, as usual. Remember that every restaurant has a story, and so without further delay, I'm excited to get this show on the road. I'm delighted to say that we have our CEO, Vivian, here with us again today. Say hi, Vivian.
Hi, everyone.
Who'll be chatting with Kim DeCarlis, the SVP of Strategic Growth at Craveworthy Brands, home to brands like Genghis Grill, Wing It On, to name just a few. Say hi there, Kim.
Hello, everyone.
As usual, Vivian, do you want to give us a quick intro into who you are for those who are not acquainted with you?
Absolutely. Great to see everyone. I'm Vivian, the founder and CEO of Landed. We help restaurants hire hourly workers, team members, up to managers, really tackling a bunch of these hot topics in the space, like who's working in your restaurant, how are they serving guests? And I'm super excited to have this conversation with Kim today because we're going to be touching on a bunch of really important topics when it comes to your labor, your staffing, who you have representing your brand.
Sweet, awesome. And Kim, next up, do you want to give us a quick little intro into who you are as well?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. So I've spent my whole career in the restaurant industry, primarily on the vendor side, but touching all areas of the business from PCI compliance to marketing, CRM, mobile ordering, online ordering, reservations, food safety, and then recently have gone over to the brand side working on the franchise sales. I've had the pleasure to come over to Craveworthy to really help the growth within the whole portfolio and benefit what I know on the vendor side to benefit our franchisees and then escalate us from there.
Awesome. I mean, and you recently joined actually Craveworthy as well. I saw it's like only in the last couple of months as well.
That's correct. Yep.
Yeah, awesome. Well, it's funny because we actually spoke twice on the phone now, like in preparation for this a couple of weeks back, actually, even before July 4. That kind of shows how much prep we put into this. But we spoke about a lot of different topics, and I feel like you spoke so well, so cogently about a number of them in particular, like guest experiences, employers, operations, and obviously post-COVID, everybody's got really strong opinions on like how we've evolved in the restaurant space since then. You did use one great phrase that I put so many asterisks and so many stars around when I was like jotting down all my notes, which was, training politeness. And I feel like, you know what, like I feel like that is a kind of cultural phrase that like I'd never heard, and it's like something that like I think this audience would like love to hear. And I'm like, let's just like dive into what you mean by that, and like how do we kind of train staff for that? How do we like bring back that sort of quality experience to dining? That seems to have been potentially lost. I'd love to hear your like explanation for that phrase.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the things that I think is super important, regardless of whatever relationship you're in, whether it's business, personal, whatever culture you're driving is what you receive back. And to be honest, that was one of the big draws for me of coming over to Craveworthy Brands was the culture that Greg is really putting into the brand as a whole is something that goes truly from the top all the way down to the managers. Greg walks into restaurants that are corporate owned and they know who he is. And when can you say when a CEO walks into a store that the general manager is excited to see someone or I miss seeing you in stores? And so that was a big draw for me. And I think, overall, whatever you're going through, whatever experience it is, retail or restaurant side, that if you have a great experience, even if it's not the results that you were looking for initially, you're still likely to go back. So being able to teach your staff, and this comes from, again, on the Craveworthy side, we have phenomenal corporate trainers. I mean, you see our trainers and you're instantly smiling as you're walking away. And being able to have that trickle down or that, let's call it infectious culture behavior, when someone's having kind of, let's call it a not an ideal day working with customers or working in stores, and they still are able to put on a smile or say, hey, this was just not our day, and still give customers that experience. Customers are going to come back even if their food doesn't look like the picture, even if their food is not ready when they did an online order. They're still willing to come back for that. I like to give kudos to Chick-fil-A. And I say this because I'm a huge Popeye's chicken sandwich fan, but I still see the lines longer. And, I still see the lines longer at Chick-fil-A. And I think it's because they're so consistent on their culture. When you drive through Chick-fil-A, you're going to feel like you were paid attention to. People are going to say, I'm so sorry for the wait. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. And you're smiling when you leave, even if it took 25 minutes for consistently good chicken. That's it. So I think there's where, you know, if you can train your staff, regardless of who's walking in, whether it's an Uber driver, a DoorDash driver, to say, welcome to the store, have proper signage and say, oh, your order's over there, or it's a guest that's coming in to place that order. I think that's really where whoever's walking in is, has the potential to be a consumer. So not treating them just saying, oh, DoorDash over there, there's still a potential to earn a guest and to consistently create a guest experience.
I love that, because when we think of like the training, that's like the, what the politeness is, you know, it keeps people coming back. And honestly, exactly like you're saying, having a standout experience and then having a good experience and then having a standout bad experience, like the standout bad experience is going to stay with you. People are going to forget about the standout good experience, but consistency and predictability. And there've been studies done on this, like not just in restaurants and hospitality, but like in business and in personal, but being able to have a predictably consistent experience. You know what you're getting when you walk through those doors. It doesn't have to be the most amazing chicken sandwich. Doesn't really matter, because you know what you're going to be getting when you walk out the door. That is like, I mean, that's huge. And so when you're thinking about training politeness, right, you guys are growing. I mean, that's part of your job, is to help grow. And you know, you have an amazing portfolio of brands, looking at more brands, looking at bringing on new franchisees that kind of have maybe their own history or their own approach to hospitality. How do you think about taking Greg and your vision and kind of letting it percolate to new franchisees, new brands that already have like some of that history?
So I think it really comes down to just always knowing to do the right thing and not letting, you know, egos, not letting titles, not letting anything kind of get into the way to know what the actual answer is. So if someone comes in and they perhaps had a bad let's call it your standout bad experience, by engaging them through our mobile apps and offering them a free sandwich or, you know, a credit of some flavor, you know, because it's the right thing to do. Did they order through third party? Are our revenues, you know, lower because of that? Sure, but it's still the right thing to do to make sure that we're doing the right thing for our guests. And that also really mirrors for our staff, right? We do a really good job, and I really do credit our operations team and our training team to say that, you know, when someone comes in for an extra shift because someone called off, we really do try to reward the team. It doesn't have to be monetary. It's just really giving someone credit where credit is due. And so just recognizing when we have the ability to roll our sleeves up and, you know, leave egos at the door to do the right thing and provide a great guest experience and a great work environment, I think that culture just fosters a contagiousness that people want to come to work and people want to come in and, you know, have a great meal.
I was going to say, like, on top of that, like, I mean, you know, we're what, like a 18 months probably in the post-COVID return to work kind of environment where restaurants are kind of back to normal again. And I suppose in one sense, like, you know, why do you think like politeness was lost? Like, what were things that like people coming back into the industry forgot to be polite, or like what has happened there? Like, why do we feel the need to train for politeness now?
That's a great question. I think during COVID, people weren't coming into restaurants. So if they were coming in, it was an order to pick up and go. And there was such an influx of order, and there was such an influx of new technology and an influx of perhaps not, you know, throttling orders in a correct way to give guests the proper expectations. So people are just coming in, and to be honest, they're just battling fires, consistently putting things out so that they can hopefully meet the tickets that are coming off. If anyone's seen the show Bear, when they turn on,
yeah, this sounds like an episode already.
We openly joke that I think real people have PTSD over that experience, that, you know, motion. So they didn't have time to say hello because they're just trying to make sure that they at least get something done. And so I think it's, you know, a good reminder that people, you know, our staff was on the front line experiencing new whether called online ordering, if they did finally, you know, start utilizing third parties, that, you know, to pick your head up and say, welcome, like you did previously, where they maybe forgot how, you know, not necessarily forgot, but they just got so in transit, and we're all guilty of this, so ingrained and so kind of focused on just the task at hand and not picking their head up and just saying, is there something I can help you with? If there's staff or there are people that are looking around, if there's not proper signage for third party, and just making sure like, hey, how can I help you? Oh, you're here to pick something up. It's over here. Again, I think that's something that we just have to perhaps take a pause, where we've been so ingrained in creating and fixing those tickets instead of just, you know, taking a moment to make sure that we're also being human.
Totally. I mean, on the candidate side, on the hiring side, right? You know, some of our partners that we work with that have really placed emphasis on this, they even have some, go so far as having a checklist of the things that they expect for managers to do when someone comes in to be a potential prospective employee. You have to offer them a glass of water. You have to say hello. You have to let them sit. Like, you know, don't just, you know, just some of these like basic things. But honestly, it's hard, because when you're a manager, like, no knock on managers, they have the hardest job. Like, honestly, I don't know a harder job than being a restaurant manager. You have tickets coming out that you're back of house. You have people that you're training. Turnover is, you know, a challenge in QSR. It is a challenge in FSR. So that's just a reality. So given that, you're always training new people. I just think about onboarding like one new person to my team and like how much that takes, right? So going so far as even having a checklist of, okay, here's how you're supposed to be treating your candidates. Here's how you treat your guests. And probably for the brands that are doing well, they don't look very different. Like, it's pretty much the same kind of checklist. And you have that, if you have that consistency, then you as a team member, you don't really have to think like, oh, how do I treat that person versus this person? Like, I mean, like a DoorDash driver versus a guest versus, you know, whatever, because honestly, anyone in restaurants, the beauty of it is that anyone could be a future guest. Anyone could be a future employee too, really. So I love that. And I think that like, you know, having some of those systems in place, we've seen brands do it, like with these checklists that are consistent, so that it's kind of like ingrained in your mind for everyone. When you go in, that's how you are. And, you know, looking for some of those characteristics initially, like, you know, we do a lot of vetting for candidates before they come in. And so like taking that brand voice and taking that brand ethos and evaluating for it upfront is like super important. So you can train it, but if they already have it to begin with, even better.
Yes, exactly. Correct. And I think it really does create a great guest experience, just because, and this sounds silly, but human nature is you just want to feel safe. So knowing you're going to go to this restaurant and you're going to create a, you know, or even retail, right? Or you buy something online. If you know the overall business model is to do the right thing, you feel safer making a purchase that perhaps you're a little apprehensive to, or what if this doesn't work? And you know that if you reach out to them, they will do the right thing and they'll make it right. And so it makes, you know, do I want to try, you know, the new poke bowl at Lucky Cat? Well, I think so. But then if my experience isn't great, I know if I reach out to the brand that they're going to say, oh, I'm sorry, it wasn't great. We recommend trying this. Here's a free dessert or free drink on us to go try that. And then now all of a sudden you're really willing to do that. And we all do this as peers even, right? Where we'll say, you tried that new restaurant down the street. You know, I tried, let's call it, wings at Wing It On. Were they good? And then as friends, we're sitting around having, you know, a drink and just catching up. And I'm saying, oh, you should go there and try that. That's the best marketing you can have, is an individual consumer sharing a great experience. And now you guys are much more likely to do that versus our phenomenal marketing team pushing things out. So that's the stuff that I think is just almost like, it's priceless. So training politeness and creating that guest experience is worth more than weight and gold.
Go on. I was going to say, it was a great phrase there. Training politeness is priceless. You know, I feel like there's a ring to that somewhere. I'm sure some HR guru has written that somewhere. I'd say
I better leave this and go target or market that as mine.
Yeah, no, you absolutely should, like right now. Just leave the podcast. One of the things I was going to say was, you know, and you mentioned marketers, and the best marketing is like your word of mouth marketing. As a fully fledged professional marketer myself, the thing that I get grilled on the most is the attribution and the source of my performance of like leads or the acquisition. And it's interesting when we talk about like, say, the sort of qualitative experience of like, how do you measure the success of like a politeness initiative? You know, like if somebody was listening to this today and it's like, oh my God, obviously it's total common sense. I want my people who work at my restaurant to be nice and welcoming and be like Chick-fil-A. How would you even go about thinking, like, how would we even measure that in the sense that what we're talking about is just a word of mouth referral, if that makes sense?
I think it's, you know, people, to Vivian's point, people always remember the bad experience. People give reviews when they're not happy. They don't rush to give reviews when they, you know, had a good experience or a mediocre experience. Everyone's not like it was good, you know? So I think there's some good platforms out there. Ovation is a really good one that we like to use that really, you know, captures the voice in a simplistic way, because there has to be a frictionless way for people to participate. So you can't over ask or over interview with, you know, the big bright spotlight asking a bunch of questions that's selfishly all the things that we want to know as a brand. Yeah. But making sure we're capturing a guest experience and then being reactive to it. Because again, going back to human nature, psychology, a restaurant is an experience. We're all in the hospitality space. So knowing that someone was heard with a good experience or a bad experience 90% of the time alleviates any concerns or again, boosts that, let's call it a reaction to go share with your friends that if you said, I had a great experience and they answered me, this big company answered me or this small company answered me. As a consumer, I think just allowing people to be heard, good, bad, or indifferent, making sure that you're using platforms to hear your guests, whether that's your mobile app or whatever it may be, and then ensuring that, you know, we just answer people, whether to your point of quantitative, you know, Facebook, everyone's using Facebook ads, people are using LinkedIn ads, and sometimes people don't know where to go, whether we have an individual that reached out on our website to get a job, but really it was our franchise website. You still owe her a call and tell her how to go there and why, because she's a human that's inquiring. So if they inbound to us, it's our job to reply. So
Yes, that's a really good point. I mean, first of all, good and bad experience, I mean, they're going to happen. So it is what it is. But the way that you communicate with the people afterwards is huge, and like making sure that it's like, you know, people might have similar challenges or maybe like similar types of feedback. And if they see that you're responsive here, like they can also take that away for their own experience.
Yep.
Other things that we like, you know, we've heard looking at are like, you know, percentages, like, okay, what percent of like this? Because exactly, you're right. People have amazing experiences. They're going to tell their friends word of mouth. That's super hard to track, but you can see the negative. And if you look at like, okay, what percent of all the guests who are coming in are getting this? I mean, of course, even consistency does not mean 100% either. Nope. Consistency means like 90% of the time you're going to be getting this, because the 10% of the time, you know, there's some space, but do we keep it below a certain threshold? So I think for a lot of the restaurants listening, like, don't stress yourself out over 100% consistency. Like, that's kind of an unachievable thing. But responding to somebody 100% of the time is an achievable thing. I mean, that's one of the big reasons why, like, for us, as soon as candidates engage, we tell restaurants that we work with, like, hey, I know that you talk about ghosting and that, you know, ghosting's a challenge in the industry, but how many times do like the candidates feel ghosted by the brands? I mean, that's all like, and ghosting is just like a point in time thing. Like someone might feel ghosted if they don't get responded to in 5 minutes, you know, and some others, you know, and then, yeah, there are other like non-business applications to that. Right. But some people might feel like they're being ghosted if you don't respond to them in an hour, in a week, you know, people have different thresholds for that. So with us, like the way that we think about, like candidates is when you're engaging with them, like just be super freaking fast, like literally in under an hour, because end of the day, candidate's going to feel ghosted, you know? So that's kind of like a little bit like the balance too, is like, okay, it's a point in time feeling. How do you like make sure that point in time feeling is a positive one?
Yep. And it's okay to get feedback, right? Like to your point, we're never going to get 100%. And if the feedback is consistent, then perhaps we need to change something on our end as well. And that's okay, because then the next consumer or the next candidate comes in feeling better, or, you know, more heard, or we correct something. So to me, communication is great. I think communication is key, good, bad, or indifferent. But you need to make sure that you have channels to have that open dialogue in whatever way it should be.
I was going to say, like, on top of that, you know, because you taking this feedback is one thing, but then applying it to like the actual guest experience is like another. And when we were chatting in our many calls, you mentioned examples of like Chipotle and Starbucks in particular, and like the effects of those, and like how they've been like optimizing their guest experiences. Yeah. Presumably, they're obviously using so much data. I mean, they're enormous businesses now, obviously, but also like on a qualitative perspective, how would you take, like, from your perspective of like, how do we take that feedback for, you say, your brands, and like apply like those kind of Chipotle effects or like Starbucks effects to like improving guest experience?
So I think one of the guest experiences, and you mentioned Chipotle, and I'll say this just because of our new Genghis grill style, where it's now behind there, but at the same time, if you go in store and order, and Alex, I'm going to pick on you, but if you're making my bowl, I can be like, can you just put a little more salsa on there? I'm not going to get charged. But if I'm ordering online, I'm going to have to pay 50 more cents for another, you know, green verde salsa. And, you know, the portions could be a little bit smaller, but overall with third party, I'm going to be paying a lot more. And so, you know, now I'm paying more money for quote unquote less food. And so how do I feel as a guest? I'm just going to, to the point, even TikTok, right? There was the huge TikTok, how to hack Chipotle online ordering. People are putting tons of effort into this to make sure that they get the same experience. And for me, I just think that making sure, this has been the whole trend of our call now, but the consistency is there however your guests come to you. So, you know, make sure portions are the same, whether they come in or not. You want double meat? No problem. But you're going to pay for it in store, out of store. And that just is expectation setting. And then once the expectations are set, there's nothing, you know, that people can necessarily can be frustrated with, because it's the same however they come to you. You know, and then I think restaurants and tech is getting a lot better. There's a lot of integrations that are coming through. There's a lot, people are working on the, let's call it the inconsistencies, where, you know, the poor Starbucks workers, you walk in, I'm the only person standing in line to make an actual order, yet they're back there and they are cranking out coffees left and right, and, you know, the unicorn drinks and all of the things. And I'm just like, why has no one waited on me yet? But they're fulfilling online orders that they put in to make them more efficient, but perhaps, you know, it hasn't been perfect yet. And so that's where I think it's important to train your frontline. It's important to make sure tech is going to be effective at the store level, not just on paper. And then also, obviously, that your guests understand that while you're standing there, there's 14 people ahead of you via online ordering that I physically cannot see. So that's where I think signage or you know, screens that show, Taco Bell does a good job of this, where they have the screens that show what order is up next. So you know where you are in line, even though you visually can't see the guests that perhaps were, you know, virtual, let's call them. So those are things that I think help set expectations at the stores.
And Vivian, go ahead.
Oh, yeah. And I, you know, I wanted to ask a question about like technology rollouts, right? Because you have operators who, honestly, for the past 3 years have gone through like 10 years of change, typical change. And so now you're like, what you just described, I mean, that would be unfathomable before, right?
Yep.
So now you have all these different things that are kind of rolling around your front line, your front of house, your back of house. They have new technologies coming to them. You know, for your front of house, maybe it's like this online are ordering and then in-person ordering, like maybe they even have drive-through, you know, kind of they're balancing. Back of house, you're putting out new menu items, you're experimenting with new things, you have new ticketing, because maybe every single third party has a different way to tell you, okay, like extra chicken, you know, like these types of things. So how are you making sure that the front line is like keeping up with all this, right? Because, you know, you have bottom line, you have top line numbers that you have to manage against, of course, and you have to keep up with the competition, which is very vigorous, but you also have this team that you have to bring along in this journey.
Yeah. So one of the things that I would encourage is either having corporate be in stores, right? At the end of the day, we need to get feedback from stores. They are really, are, it's like guerrilla warfare out there. It's like, let's throw it out there and see if hopefully it works. What do you guys think? It's like, not good or kind of good. And, you know, I didn't get shot over here. So I think it's something that need to take feedback constructively and understand what's actually working and if it's solving the why if we installed it, right? That we hired a vendor to solve this problem. Is it solving that problem or creating six more? So that's something that you need to always evaluate. And we do something called a postmortem. So reviewing what we put in to say reflectively, was this a good decision or bad? Because hindsight's 2020, but it was a good decision at the time. But, you know, you only grow stronger by making decisions quickly, you know, and making sure that you think what your decision is the best one at the time, but then making sure that you can reflect and say, just because we made that decision 6 months ago doesn't mean we need to consistently make that decision. And how can we improvise on that to make it correct? And so that's one thing that we do really well. And then I would also say that, you know, we own corporate stores. And that's one thing, again, that I you know, tip my hat to Greg on making sure that he owns a store. So he is wearing multiple hats as the CEO of Craveworthy, but also as the operator and owner of a location. So if his staff is coming to him saying, you know, this new system you put in is junk, well, then Greg is losing money. I mean, it's financial, which our operators are, no offense, I mean, that's what they're focused on and they should be focused on. And then if it's, you know, it's only crap for this reason, let's talk through why that is. And he can then now empower the people that we have to make or fix or, you know, change the direction of which we were going.
Yeah, I have some things to add to that, because I guess something that we do when we start working with our restaurant groups is we always do something called benchmarking.
Yep.
So let's like benchmark, let's notch where you are right now across these different things. And more often than not, when we do benchmarking, we realize that they don't have the benchmark data or the benchmark sentiment either. So whether it's qualitative or quantitative, so we need to go in there and we need to set that benchmark. And then we need to measure the delta. It's always about measuring the difference. It's not really like, honestly, even about the absolute value. It's like, okay, what difference did this make and how quickly did that difference like come to be?
Yep.
And then having ways of like gathering that feedback. So I love that, you know, that Craveworthy has corporate locations, probably where you are experimenting with new things, because you have your rock star general managers who you know are gonna be give you the unfiltered advice. Yep. Or unfiltered feedback, which is so desperately needed. And then, but then also like kind of bringing along 10 people for the initial journey versus bringing along 500 people for the initial journey is just like a lot easier to like just get like to cut out noise. I think that honestly, in restaurants, there's like so much noise. You have different data. And yeah, maybe like, you know, I'm in hiring world, so I think about that a lot. But you know, last month, this type of hiring, but now we're in back to school. We, you know, we're basically, we're going to blink and it's going to be September, right? And so with that, how many people, you know, we have their seasonality that's kind of folded in. So if you roll out something during back to school season, well, that's going to be very different than last month versus rolling something out during Thanksgiving, Black Friday, holiday. That's also part of it. So, I think that like, just for folks who are listening, right? Like make sure you're benchmarking too. And make sure that you actually have data before you start something. If you don't have data, don't start it. Cause you're not going to know what the ROI is.
And it is so crazy.
I like that.
This is a true like situation right now at Craveworthy. We opened a Genghis Grill right on Ohio State's campus. And we did it a month ago because we want the staff trained. I mean, how many people come into Ohio State for the schools?
I grew up in Columbus, Ohio. So
you understand, right? So we're in Gateway. It's right there. We need to make sure the staff is ready. And then it's like welcome weekend. We're ready. And we have promotions going. And, you know, we have those things because that is going to be an insane influx of all things. So we're ready. So that's one thing that we've done. And, you know, I tip my hat to our operations and training team for being prepared with that. And then our marketing team, who's ready to advertise when everyone gets there.
I can't wait. I go back often, and I'm going to go back to the OSU Michigan game upcoming, but I'm very excited to see this new location. But I mean, I love like the sentiment, right? It's there's a lot of stuff going on and getting that feedback from people and then like that having that learning loop be fast. Because I love what you just said, Kim. You're like, the decision that you made is not always the decision you have to continue to make.
Nope.
You can always pivot, and if you have smart people in the room and people who are like, you know, have ownership, they're going to pivot. So
my favorite, oh, I'm sorry. I was going to say one of my favorite lines, and I learned this from my, one of my mentors, my bosses, is that you make decisions on an island, you're going to die on the island. But if you make it as a team, then the team goes down together and the team can pivot and no one feels left out, right? It's like, we made this decision as a team. You can agree to disagree, but you leave the room aligned on what direction you're headed. And then you can reevaluate that. And that's something that I think creates and fosters an environment of collaboration and creativity and no one feeling like fingers are being pointed or, you know, this one is on me and scorekeeping is happening. And so those are things that I think leaving at the door when you go into a room really helps foster the growth and what you're trying to do as a catalyst to grow the company.
I mean, what an awesome sentiment to effectively close the book on this episode of Fast Casual. I love that. Like, but tell me, I suppose, Kim, like, I mean, is that your, that probably is your takeaway, your last, your final thought for the episode. I was just going to say, is there a final thought or a takeaway, or is there, would you add anything else like from this episode?
No, I think this conversation could go on for hours. We could have a lot of people in the room who feel and want to be, you know, collaborate with us. But I had a wonderful time with you guys today. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Great stuff.
Thank you. This is super fun. And I'm very, very excited to see the new location, and congrats on all the growth, and you know, big fan of what y'all are building. And I will turn it over to Alex.
All right. Well, as always, everybody, I like to say every restaurant has a story, every business has a story, and we're here to learn the playbooks that built the world's greatest restaurants and how you can apply them as a founder, owner, operator, or investor yourself. Thank you very much, Kim, for joining us today. Thank you, everyone, for listening, and we will see you all next week. Have a lovely day, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.